Paul, how are you, man?
I'm good. Good to see you again, Alan.
You too. You too. So one of the things that I thought we would actually bring up is, we talk about addressable advertising a lot. And one of the things that we've been finding lately is, especially when it comes to, to CTV, there's addressable and then there's addressable. So one of the things we found is a lot of people are using addressable, to increase reach, to get incremental reach. And that's often done against a much broader target. It's like, hey, I need to reach, women 18 to 49, and I'm gonna buy them on CTV versus sort of what's, true addressable, which is I wanna buy women 18 to 49 who are in the market for an SUV because I have first party data that shows that they're in the market for an SUV. So, what are you guys seeing since we did the report, which is a couple months back, about that?
That is a great question, and I think you're right. The alphabet soup that is our industry, is it CTV, is it OTT, what SSP am I using, what's this, that,
Yes.
how do I stitch these technologies together are definitely a question. One of the things when we did the research report, I think that we found is that simple is better, and we've been spending the past, 3 months or so trying to figure out how to get this simple. So I'll try this on with you a little bit and as a way to answer this question, right?
Sure, that's perfect.
What's changing is the delivery of TV, not the content that's in TV, right? And the reason, and that TV is being, that delivery is being changed from either an over-the-air antenna or a set-top box to an IP-enabled device that may be connected to a wire or that may be connected to some 5G network or something. But the delivery has changed, and that is opening up a plethora of new targetable media that has not been there before. So to answer your question, TV used to be addressable only at the demo-based level, right? 18 to 49, because that's the only media that was available to address these programs. But as we've moved into the era not only of CTV, but of better technology, viewer graphs, right? Cookieless graphs, like the one we use at Kadant, that can actually bring your linear TV into the digital world, you now have a larger pool of addressable targeted media that is in that TV content that hasn't changed. And so, it used to be that I could just target the voice on, say, 18 to 49, and now I can target the voice on pizza lovers who wear black t-shirts. And so I think the way to think about that, if you're a marketer, is that with that delivery mechanism changing, we're getting more addressable targeting available in the TV content that used to not be there. We used to have to go to other types of content on the internet to get that targetability, and we don't have to do that anymore. We can actually get that through those same TV shows.
And how important is it though for brands to have their own first party data now? Like, are there other ways to get that kind of data to help with targeting?
Yeah, that's another really good question. As a marketer, I think you got to control your own destiny, right? And that if your team doesn't have data competency within it and you're relying just on third partners to either provide that strategy to you or manage your data for you, you're going to fall behind. And that's probably not a controversial statement right now, just considering the year we've been in. I like what Jill just said. She called it like the rise of the homebody economy. If there's anything that the homebody economy has taught marketers is that if we don't have data, especially to understand behaviors and specifically the TV viewing habits, which device, which time on demand versus live stream and what the differences are, you're lost. And I think that a foundation moving forward is your customers, your prospects, your first party data, and having a good internal understanding of what the data is, how to use it, how fresh it is, where it works, where it needs to be augmented, and then being able to go out to partners and say, I have this asset, help me leverage it into channel A, channel B, channel C.
So we're at peak streaming right now, which is pretty crazy. There are nine of these, we call them Flixes, these nine multi-billion dollar services. There are, a whole bunch of the free ad-supported streaming TV services, and dozens of pretty popular niche services as well. So you could very much make the argument that there's more and better content on streaming, often for less money. And basically, unless you're subscribing to 10 certain the premium version of 10 services, you're paying less than you would pay for cable. So given all that, one of the things we had found in this study is that there are, there's not every marketer, but there's still, a core that are kind of skeptical of this new world. And, right. What do you tell them to kind of get them over the hump?
Yeah, I'm going to repeat what Jill just said too, or even the analogy you just said, right? It's not how well the bear dances, it's the fact that the bear is dancing. And so the way that I think about it is, like, don't let perfect be the enemy of good when it comes to moving into connected television, because by the time it's perfect, your audience is going to be already there and settled in and watching your competitors. What's important right now is to have that data competency and start moving into more addressable mediums when it comes to television, because the learnings you get, whether it's the campaign results, whether it's just the operational learnings you get within your team, with your external partners on how to make it work more efficiently and how to streamline it, are super important moving forward, as that audience continues to migrate to those more targetable mediums, right? And I'm gonna say one other thing about those flicks, as you said, I'm one of those marketers, right? That, every marketer, especially when you're learning, I got my first agency job, you always dream of like doing a Super Bowl commercial, right? So I love TV and I love the TV industry. And those streaming services are producing good content, but let's not forget that some of those streaming services are streaming what we consider linear TV or live TV, right?
Yeah.
That are on there. And so that content doesn't just include the new stuff that we're talking about, the Hulu original series. That content includes, the back catalog of Law and Order or Friends or those other things that are tried and true series. And the stuff that's coming out today, I have a 10-year-old that loves watching Guy's Grocery Games, and he watches it. He's 10, figured out. He loves watching it live on the app because it's just, that's how he knows to navigate. It's easier for him to navigate to the Food Network app. I think now it's Discovery Plus, right?
Yeah.
It's either there, but he watches it in real time. Why? Because he's like texting with his buddies about, ew, can you believe they put hot sauce in that? And that kind of communal experience on live is super valuable as well. So I think it's a kind of a corollary and important for marketers is, like I said, the delivery mechanism changed, but the viewing experiences are still there. You have that sort of communal live experience and you have that on-demand experience. It's just, am I clicking on an app or am I clicking, on my remote control, on my set-top?
Gotcha. No, that makes perfect sense. And to your point, say Paramount Plus is an easy example. If you get the premium version, you get the live feed of CBS and the Super Bowl, and all of the networks that have access to the Super Bowl made sure they got streaming rights in the last 11-year deal that the NFL so cleverly put together. And so, it's every, like, you will get your commercial on the Super Bowl.
Well, even if you're doing streaming. Right. Taking back to your question prior is like, should I do this? Right. If I'm a marketer, and the answer is absolutely, because that audience is now, they're all watching Paramount properties. They just happen to be watching it on two different delivery mechanisms. And so the marketer challenge is, how do I know how to bring that audience together after the fact to see what result I got? And that's technology is solving that problem today. That's what our viewer graph does at Caden. There are multiple places there, but the research that we did said, I don't know if I should move here because I want to be perfect. And that was a lot of the hesitancy we saw in the data. And I think the answer is, look, it's not perfect. It's messy, right? This is TV. People watch in different places and times. And, you can watch, when we're all back in the office, we can watch on an elevator on our phone right now.
Right.
It's messy. You need tech to sort it out. But don't let that messiness prevent you from getting started.
No, that's an excellent point. And it's going to be messy for the next while. Like things, TV changes slowly compared to other media, right?
We're humans. We're not ones and zeros. Yeah. There's always going to be analog and fuzzy natures because we're all not robots, right? And I think that we see that in every other aspects of marketing, right? When I was at a DSP, I used to say, sometimes the reason why someone didn't click on the ad wasn't, everything the algorithm told you. It was because they spilled coffee on their shoe. And then they were late for work and they left the laptop running. And that's human nature is a part of this. But you can't let that stop you from trying to reach your audience wherever your audience is.
No, that's an excellent point. And on that note, I'm getting the beep that we should be wrapping up here and bringing on the next crew. So thanks, man. It was great to reconnect.
Good to see you again.
Yeah, you too. Those of you out in the audience, you can download the paper from the Brand Innovator site, I'm sure from Cadence site as well. So thank you very much, Paul. And next up, we are going to have Josh Palau, I'm probably pronouncing that wrong, the Chief Media and Activation Officer at PHD. And his session is going to be moderated by Mike Moreau, who is the co-founder and COO at either at Habu or Habu. Again, I'm missing pronunciations here.
Boy, you got all